carrier of the supreme Vajra. Podcast episode 240, Padmasambhava part 15. This is, I will continue reading the life and liberation of Padmasambhava, picking up right where we left off last time. For those who are impatient to get to these recitals, there is a link to where you can get a free copy of this exact book. There's two volumes, a book like this and one that looks almost exactly like it, in PDF, and you can read it on your own if you'd like. This is just for those who like to have me read things to them. So this is the life story of Padmasambhava as recorded by Yeshe Tsogyal. According to tradition, it's one of those things that was found, I think, 700 or 800 years later. It's all in the credits, in those the opening credits where it said retrieved or discovered by, that kind of thing. All that information is available online if you'd like to search for the life and liberation of Padmasambhava and find out the details. But it's safe to say that for the past 500 years or so, this has been considered by many to be the life story of Padmasambhava, dictated to Yeshe Tsogyal, his consort, his student, his girlfriend, the queen of the region where he was at the time in Tibet, giving them all the Vajrayana teachings. And she had a photographic memory, so she wrote it all down, or perhaps made someone else memorize it, and eventually it was written down and then recovered. And now here it is in English. So I guess that's it. I will go ahead and get to the reading. I think just to be simple today, we'll go with the Henry Wolfe and Nancy Hennings Tibetan Bells 1 album from the 70s. And if you'd like, oh, well, since I'm in the middle of mentioning that, if you'd like to listen to this album on your own, when this is over, or now, perhaps you'd like, you know what, this music sounds cool, but this guy's voice, I don't know, I'll just listen to the album. That's, you're free to do that. I'll try not to. Anyway, but if you would like to start at the beginning of the Padmasambhava recitals, at the beginning of this book, rather than the middle, or right in the middle of the first volume, here's the Padmasambhava playlist for the recitals on Buddhist Books Podcast. Might be a little confusing because the first two recitals on that Padmasambhava playlist are actually on a different podcast, but it's me, but it's different. I'll get to the reading now. Canto 28. The request made to Ananda concerning the sutras to be used in instruction. Then the guru Shakya Sang spoke to Ananda, the best listener. Quote, how many sutras and mantras have been recorded in writing, and taking into account the various manuscripts, as many as there are, in what places are they kept? I am attentive to your saintly virtue. Speak. End quote. This was Ananda's reply. Quote, from the parinirvana of Munindra to the present, the Buddha's words, transcribed without abridgment and arranged in books, both texts and holy dharma make 500 loads for a robust elephant. Since gods and Nagas have been quarreling about where to place them, the unabridged Sata Sahasrika was concealed as a treasure in the domain of the Nagas. Those are like snake gods, basically. This is Naga Kanya, the queen of the Nagas. Anyway, sorry. The Pranya Paramita, in 20,000 lines, was hidden in the territories of the Sakras. That in 10,000 lines, in the dwelling of the Titans. That in 8,000 lines, in the land of Vaishravana. The Pranya Paramita Sankhya Gatas were hidden in the town of Puspamati. The Shesra Snyingpo was hidden in fortunate Brahmo. The 10 sutras of provisional meaning were hidden in the land of Tukara. The Avatamsaka Sutra was hidden in the Diamond Throne. Incidentally, there's a copy of that right behind me. The Mother Scripture and its 16 derivatives were hidden in the land of Sala. The Lalita Vistara was hidden in the land of Brusa. The Bhadra Kalpika in the land of copper. That if the Urten Brel Snyingpo in the land of Sukhara, I assume that was supposed to be that of. It's okay to have one or two typos. The Lanka Vatara was hidden in the land of ogres. The Geser Ad Dampa at the peak of Mount Meru. The Avatamsaka in the land of China. The Ratnakuta was hidden in Vaisali. The Padma Dekarpo in Mount Potala. Also hidden were Basad Skyabs Badud Ertsi Lnyingha in Bengal. I'm sure I'm not pronouncing these things correctly. The Ernam Gzigs Choski Melong in the land of Baida. The Odd Shrungs Stongpa Ernam Bied in Kashmir. The Che Fro Bastanpa in the land of Kangbu. The Maha Pari Nirvana Sutra in the monastery of Vikram Asila, and the totality of the formulas in the land of Udiana. The 5 tantras of the Bhikkha Gadams were hidden in the thunder rock. The Zagpa Medpa, both the great vehicle and the small, were hidden in the lake in the river Nairanjana. Hidden also were Manjushri's basic tantra in Kamarupa, the Sintamani in Megadda, the five Dharanis in the cemetery of the Chili Grove. The Ratna Ketu Dharani in the land of Kangbu. The Upadesas in the Central Park and elsewhere. And the Bukha Kor Bazi was hidden in the land of Zahur. While the doctrine of the Buddha remains preserved in the openness, it is in the sky, in the abodes of the Nagas, in the rocks, waters, and trees, in the mountains, caverns, borderlands, and charnel grounds, in the monasteries, the stupas, and at Nalanda. So, the time that this is attributed to, the 8th century, Nalanda stood. When it was recovered, it had already been destroyed 3 centuries earlier. So that's interesting. Okay. I mean this text, when the text was recovered. Okay. Just because I can't resist an opportunity to show off pictures of my wife and I at Nalanda, the place that they're talking about. In the regions of the Gandharvas, Kumbandas, Yaksas, and Nagendras, that the sutras have been deposited and are propagated. The world's greatest treasures at the mercy of kings, of robbers, of fire and water, will be reduced to nothing. This treasure of the holy Dharma of the Tathagata, hidden thus, will remain indestructible throughout many eras. And in later times, these books will come to light, as has been predicted. After the nirvana of the sage and the lapse of 28 years, King Ujjayin will appear. After the nirvana of the Tathagata, and when 80 years have gone by, in the west, in the land of Udayana, will appear Bhadradeva Palita, who will teach the three yogas. When I am no longer there and 400 years have elapsed, the Bhikshu Nagarjuna will appear. He will be faithful to the tradition and will maintain it. After the nirvana of the Tathagata, when 350 years have been numbered, Buddha Guya will appear, emanating a magic power whose benefits will be noted. Counting from my nirvana, at the end of 570 years, the son of the commander of the five regions, Sri Humkara, will appear. Counting from my nirvana, at the end of 800, almost 900 years, in the land of Ziyanta, two pure brothers will appear. And the Abhidharma will be propagated. When I am no longer there, and when after my nirvana, 42 years have passed by, then summoned forth by his previous deeds in the country of Simhala, setting aside ordinary birth and being born miraculously, will appear Padmasambhava of the prodigious feats, challenged to debate by Aryadeva and emerging victorious, learned in exegesis. Counting from my nirvana, after the lapse of 550 years, at Gandu in Zahur, the son of King Gomati, a bodhisattva will appear. Also in the land of Kashmir in the west, at the Oxen Hill, Vimalamitra will appear. His magic powers, his benedictions, and his virtues will be famous in the land of the red faces, when after the master's nirvana 1500 years have elapsed, the good law will appear in the direction of the land of piety. To the north, amid the snowy mountain chains, the good law will flourish. After my parinirvana, a being like myself will comment upon the victorious meanings. In actual truth, it is I by whom the sastras will be explained. Thus did he speak. Of the history unabridged of the lives of the guru of Uddiyana, Padmasambhava. This is the 28th canto, the request made to Ananda concerning the sutras to be used in instruction. Sealed Oaths. Okay. I'll keep reading. Canto 29. The sojourn in the cemetery of Body's End, where he received the name Nyima Odzer. Then the bhiksu Shakya Sang came to the country called Baida, in which is the great cemetery of Body's End, with a perimeter of 3.5 leagues. At the center is the Mount Potala Stupa, built of a precious crystal substance. In the rear is the great monastery of Sairima. In the east is the supernatural tree which radiates magic force, a tree of the tombs frequented by many birds of the tombs. Beneath dwell thaumaturges of non-human race, who turn beautiful women into bitches. I'm pretty sure they mean female dogs, the older usage of the word bitches. In India, they still use that word to mean female dog, which can be sort of funny when you come from America like I do. When I first met the one who later became my wife, she was recounting a tale of when she was young and she had the cutest bitch, and she loved that bitch so much, and she misses that bitch. And I'm just like, she's like, what? What is it? I'm like, it just sounds really funny to an American ear to hear that. Sort of old-timey British English. Anyway, all right, sorry. Sometimes I get distracted. I'll try to stick to the text. Who change pebbles and pieces of wood. Okay, so this is who turn beautiful women into bitches. Who change pebbles and pieces of wood into living beings and skeletons. who change planets, stars, sun and moon into desiccated corpses and work all sorts of similar prodigies. To the south of the cemetery, and formed by the water from the tombs, is the lake of contiguity, which has at its center skeletons issuing from a fivefold lotus stand. And all around, the intimate glow of the crematory fires reveals amid the flames bodies opened or in pieces, with skins, hands, feet, flesh, or in decay, burnt, not burnt, or burnt incompletely. To the west, the obituary wind spirals in tempest force, and in the wind's mist, troops of bhutas, that's B-H-U-T-A-S, and of the deceased riding on children, sheep, bulls, and skeletons bear off, some of them the infirm, some the dead, some of them snot, some fire and water, some of them melted fat, and some strips of flesh. I hope nobody's eating while listening to this. To the north lies moving vastness, the mountain of tombs, and there the king of the mountain of tombs, intensely busy, presides amid the abodes of all the funeral prowlers, and at his waist he has a Sintamani treasure. From there, in an easterly direction, the god protector of the world, Mahapalasvara, with a yak's body and a lion-faced head, terminating in a serpent shape and mounted on a rakshasa, holds the katvanga. That's the katvanga. And raises the cadaver banner. And he is surrounded by shadowy silhouettes, beings of every sort of manner who transform themselves at will. Now, to the south, with mind expanded and his face having turned a deep red, the saint entered into ecstasy. And in this charnel ground, his back against the stupa, he remained for 5 years, expounding the Dharma to the Dakinis. Thereupon the name of Nyima Odzer was bestowed on him, and action for the benefit of others stretched forth its fruits and branches. Of the history unabridged of the lives of the Guru of Uddiyana, Padmasambhava, this is the 29th canto, the sojourn in the cemetery of body's end, sealed oaths. That bird, this time of day, he's always, I don't know what he's doing. Canto 30, the sojourn in the cemetery. Radiant beatitude, where he received the name Lodan Chogsed. Now, in quest both of a doctrine of knowledge and of salvation together, in which with few words a great meaning might appear, Nyima Odzer went to the palace of the plane of essence, in Akanista heaven. Okay. There resides the master of the essence body, Samantabhadra. Blue in color, sitting on the throne of lions, he wears every kind of ornament and a headdress of the five Buddha lineages. empyrean of serenity. He irradiates in a rainbow. Nyima Odzer places himself on the earth below. Lord of sight, he sees with his lips the words of the doctrine. Lord of hearing, he hears future speech. Lord of mind, he scrutinizes the meaning of the words conceived. Eminently perfect, depth of non-action. Original circle, including the 18 spiritual bases. Great heaven, songbird of knowledge. Great Garuda, soaring, holding mastery high. Sextuple meaning meditated six times, in other words. Triumphant peak arisen. Celestial King, happiness set with gems. Universal, perfect activity, synthesis of all the gems. Wheel of life, indubitable bodhisattva. Highly accomplished, vast happiness, link of the universal life. Majestic, holy. Gem of wishes, deep, fruitful contemplation. He is the gold melted in the stone. He is called, as a secret name, carrier of the supreme Vajra. With his joyous energy, he is delighted. He is smoothness. He fills with his voice the horizons of glory. Now, there is in the land of Kashmir the cemetery of sleep with mysterious ways called Radiant Beatitude, which is 5.5 leagues in circumference. In the center is the stupa Kanika, which arose alone. With beautiful colors, a natural place of all religion, the dwelling of the great Lamia Kairima. In the north, the great tree of the tombs, which takes by the nose, bears many cemetery creatures, both langurs and small monkeys. Oh, langurs, those are like the monkeys with the black faces and the gray fur, I think. And there are dakinis who perform mudras while dancing. Beneath the water of the tombs, horrible decay, is a teeming of creatures of the tombs, some laughing, others weeping, others who quarrel and who kill. In the south of the cemetery roars the fire of the cremations, spontaneous fire, which jumps with the noise of a mouse and a crash which is heard at a league's distance. And within the fire, many gods of the fire rising from goats hold sacrificial spatulas made of hollow bones. In the west is the funeral wind, whirling companion. And in the gusts are numerous ghouls who carry away cadavers and blow in the manner of flutes in shin bones which they have on hand. In the northwest is the king of the mountain of the tombs with 100 peaks. And there remain many creatures of the tombs who have a treasure of miraculous gems. On the northeast side, the empusa who squints, blue, wearing trousers of red cotton, has the beak of a peacock, the eyes of an owl, and the six necklaces of bones on its breast. There is a mirror in the middle of its forehead. And its opulent coil of hair is tied with the vajra circle. It flays with its two hands, mannequins with human skin. In the southwest, on a mule, is the goddess fiend of the tombs. And in this cemetery, with his back against the stupa, the saint, for 5 years, made the wheel of the Dharma turn for the Dakinis. Next, he set out for the land of Bengal, and in the town which is called House of Prophecies, there was the Bonpo Yungshen. When the saint appeared like the sun in the sky, the Bon priest left. A little time later, the Bonpo, drunk on millet beer, lost his gong with the 3,000 sounds. Now a hungry man, who was looking for his lost cow, did not find his cow, but found the Bonpo's gong. He took it away to his house, and his children beat the gong. The Bonpo, looking for his gong, found the cow, milked her, and gave the milk to his children. The Bonpo accused the poor man of having stolen the gong. The hungry man accused the Bonpo of having stolen his cow. They brought their dispute before the king of Kashmir. Quote, exchange the cow and the gong, end quote, said the king. Quote, and don't quarrel anymore, end quote. The hungry man led his cow away, and the Bonpo carried away his gong. But the wife of the hungry man said, quote, milk was taken, end quote. And she and her children yelped reproaches. The hungry man then said, quote, the fact is that the Bonpo has taken some milk, end quote. And the Bonpo said, quote, you have beaten my gong, I protest, end quote. Quote, what does it matter that it was beaten? It was not worn. And quote, quote, what difference does it make to have milked the cow? She is not dry, end quote. For lack of agreement, they went back to the king's court, and the Bonpo told of the cow, and the poor man told of the gong, and they demanded the cow not yet milked and the gong before it was beaten. Quote, yes, so be it, end quote, said the king, and they went away. But on the road, the hungry man killed the Bonpo. After which, he took up with the Bonpo's wife. The wife of the hungry man notified her brother, and they tied up her husband and took the body of the Bonpo to the king. Quote, let the guilty one, end quote, said the king, quote, keep company with the corpse. Let him be put on the cow and beaten with the Bonpo's gong. Seems fair. For the one who is looking, finding is not good. Losing is not good either. Since everything has not been considered, may the affair not be concluded, end quote. When the order was given, they were walked around the town and led to the cemetery, radiant beatitude. The holy Nyima Odzer inquired, quote, what is the crime? End quote. The hungry man lied, quote, a Bonpo killed my father, and I, the son, am accompanying his body. End quote. Hearing this, The saint saved the life of the hungry man as well as of his cow, admitted him to fix freely with the masters of the cemetery, and said, quote, "Your cow is saved. You may live by means of its milk and listen to the Dharma." End quote. But the other one said, quote, "I have a wife and children." End quote. Quote, "That you have a wife and children makes no difference according to the Dharma. There is the mantra circle crowned with rosettes. Toward the land of the Buddha, the troop which you led will be directed." End quote. Upon this, the hungry man, discontented, said to himself, quote, "Samanian liar with vain words, such impostures. When he is pretending to be a priest, he acts like a magician. And when he is pretending to be a magician, he acts like a priest. The women who are here are surely his, as are the children, whatever they may be." End quote. But in spite of this false judgment, he did as the saint wished. Next, his cow died, and he no longer had any livelihood. Now, Nyima Odzer said to the creatures of the tree of the tombs, quote, "Do not harm this man. Let him eat the fruits of the tree." End quote. Therefore, the hungry man was protected by the langurs and the monkeys from being devoured. Fruits were spread out in front of him on the right and on the left, and he wondered if, by means of the benediction, he would be able to go and get his wife and children. As he was climbing down from the tree, a branch broke under his feet. His body suspended, he held himself back with his hands, but it cracked again, and he fell into the waters of the tomb's horrible decay, where numerous creatures of the tombs made ready to devour him. The little monkeys protected him, and the langurs held him up underneath the great tree. Quite a fight was brewing. The man was still not safe. All the langurs sat down on top of the tree trunk. The little monkeys hung by their tails. Each langur seized the tail of the neighbor monkey, and the hungry man climbed up the chain of monkeys. He was passed at arm's length and was drawn up above. Then the langurs passed in the same way each little monkey. The hungry man, by holding himself to the tree, came down. Langurs and monkeys had all gone to sleep from fatigue. Quote, "When I have brought my wife and children," end quote, he thought, quote, "they will need fruits to eat," end quote. So he shook the trunk of the great tree, causing the langurs and monkeys at the first blow to fall into the lake of the charnel house, and to be seized by the creatures of the waters of the tombs. The hungry man then came before the guru, quote, "Carried away by the wind, langurs and monkeys have fallen into the waters of the tombs," end quote, he said. Quote, "I, by holding myself to the tree, found refuge and safety," end quote. At the words of the guru, disgusted, said, quote, "If one disdains great profit, how can one incur great damage? If one lives obscurely, how can one be desirous? If one is guilty and tells many lies, where is honesty? If one has extinguished desire, where can evil be? You can no longer go out of this cemetery. By the Amanusa, you would be devoured alive." End quote. But the hungry man harbored resentment. Quote, "Why is there a difference between us? Whoever is implacable to me should be ferocious to you. If the Amanusa devour me, they should also devour you." End quote. and the 10 offenses filled the depth of his breast. With that, the eminent one became fiercely compassionate. He said, quote, I am going to lead you into the midst of your family, end quote. And so the poor man left the frightful cemetery and found himself reunited with 7 of his family. There was great mutual joy. Then the husband led them, wife and children, to eat the fruits of the tombs. But on the road, he was devoured by the wild beasts. On hearing this, all beings endowed with reflection were converted. The great benevolent one acted like a father and mother, and he was named Guru Lodan Chogsed. Of the history unabridged of the lives of the Guru of Udayana, Padmasambhava, this is the 30th canto. The sojourn in the cemetery, radiant beatitude, sealed oaths. Well, all right. Very interesting. I hope that you enjoyed it. And feel free to come back and see our regular episodes, the recitals of the Tipitaka, a pre-sectarian early Buddhism, the foundation of what eventually became this and many other forms of Buddhism. Not having anything to say at this time, I will go ahead and do the closing. Best wishes to you. To the north and to the south, to the east and to the west, to the spirits of light among us and to the spirits below, we send out our reverent love and compassion. May all beings be happy. May all beings be serene. May all beings be in peace. Until next time.